Well, hello again. We're back for yet another hour on Beowulf. And last time, we had been looking at the first part of the poem. And what we're going to be doing now is continuing and looking pretty much at the major portions of the rest of the work within the next hour or so. One thing I did want to stress, because I don't think that I gave it sufficient attention perhaps last time, and that is the whole question of unity in Beowulf. Now remember that I did say something about how a lot of literary critics were concerned about the question of overall unity, because you'll notice that the plot does not move in an altogether straightforward direction. And there's a fair amount of moving forwards and sometimes moving backwards, sometimes moving sideways, as it were, to bring in some story from apparently outside the poem altogether. We're going to see a couple of those as we go along. For example, when the shop or court poet sings of the story of Sigmund in celebration of Beowulf's victory over Grendel. And you sort of go, well, what does that have to do with the story of Beowulf? Well, it's a celebration. And this, too, is a great legendary figure from the northern Germanic mythological culture. And he was a dragon slayer, the slayer of a dragon, the slayer of a great monster who had guarded over a hoard of treasure. Well, there is a certain appropriateness here in the singing of a lay or narrative song about Sigmund. And the same kind of thing is true elsewhere. Towards the end of the work, as we'll see today, there's a lot of backtracking to fill in historical details, or what at least are presented to us as historical details, about feuds among the Swedes and so forth, all of which explain how we got to the point of Beowulf being king in the first place, and the various complexities of the relations between the Geats and their neighbors, which now, with the death of Beowulf, are going to issue in all kinds of problems. You know, as we learn at the very end of the poem, we have a forecast that once the word gets around, as it will very quickly, that Beowulf is dead, the great protector of the Geatish people, then those enemies who have been waiting for their chance are going to descend upon the Geats. And then it is going to be very, very bad indeed for the Geats. So we have a lot of these narratives and narratives within narratives and sidelight narratives and so forth that actually do bear on the main story, but in ways that may not be immediately apparent. What most scholars agree with is Tolkien's notion of the overall unity of the poem in his famous work that I mentioned last time, Beowulf, the Monsters, and the Critics. And whether one agrees or disagrees with Tolkien on this detail or that detail, Tolkien has set the terms of the discussion so that everybody who discusses Beowulf since 1936, when he first published that, and that's a pretty long time ago now, but since that time, everybody has really argued about Beowulf on his terms, or at least primarily on his terms. And his great argument, as I was mentioning last time, but let me stress this again, is that the poem is really divided into great segments, so that we have the early part of the poem, which celebrates the heroic and youthful qualities of Beowulf. And then in the latter part of the poem, we have the older Beowulf. Actually, he's a pretty old man. Though he can fight very hard for an old man, even against such a horrendous monster as the dragon. And he almost pulls it off. Not quite, but he almost pulls it off. So he hasn't lost that much of his strength with age. But nonetheless, his days are numbered. And we are constantly told in that latter part of the poem that his time has now expired, that this is going to be the end for Beowulf. And he himself realizes that. He himself reminisces about some of his earlier fights, not simply against Grendel and Grendel's mother, but also against the Frankish warrior champion Dagrafin, who in your translation is called Day Raven. And he's thinking about the fact that in the past he's been able to go out and fight great adversaries without weapons. We see that in the case of his fighting against Grendel and Grendel's, well, he doesn't really fight without weapons with Grendel's mother, because he ultimately relies on the magical power of what appears to be a very special and charmed sword. But then when he fights the Frankish champion, Day Raven, or Dagrafin, as the original has it, what he does is he crushes the guy to death in this gigantic bear hug, you know, which also has led some scholars to think about Beowulf's name even in this way. The bee wolf, or the wolf of the bees, is the bear. That is to say, who is the adversary of the bee? Talking about the little bees that go buzzing around and have honeycombs. Well, the wolf of the bees is the bear, right? Who goes after the beehives and takes away all of the honey. Well, okay, let's just say that Beowulf has some bear-like qualities, and in particular, in his ability to fight great adversaries without the help of weapons. But in his old age now, when he realizes he's going to have to go forth and fight against the dragon, he realizes that his strength is that much less than it was before, that he now will have to depend on his armor and on his weapons. And there's a certain kind of sadness here, but it's a heroic sadness. Because while he realizes that this time he very likely will not survive, nevertheless, he still realizes as a hero of epic must that this is something he must do. This is simply a question of honor. And he must go forth as the protector of his people. So what Tolkien then is arguing, among other things, is that there is a kind of overall unity to the poem in the way these two opposing themes or tones are balanced against each other. In addition to that, he makes a quite convincing argument that Christianity is not simply a kind of overlay, as some earlier scholars had argued. They had argued that Beowulf really was an essentially, if you want to call it, pagan poem. And then some monkish scribe came along and simply inserted some Christian references and some Christian sentiments here and there. And part of what Tolkien argues is that these Christian references are actually integral to the poem, even to the structure of the poem as a narrative poem. And so once again, if you want to argue with that, you're arguing essentially on the terms that Tolkien laid down. He also talks about other great symbolic oppositions in the poem, such as light versus dark. You have Heorot, which is a hall associated with light, and everything that goes along with the symbolism of light. Light, joy, happiness, comradeship, the delight in the feasting, and the music and the tale telling that we constantly hear is taking place in the Mead Hall. And it is precisely the light and all that the light connotes that angers Grendel. Remember, he not only comes from the darkness, but he is a creature of darkness, and he hates the light, and he hates the people of the light. And so this then also becomes another one of those great symbolic oppositions in the poem. Or between the earlier part, where we have a great emphasis on light, and the emphasis on dark later on in the poem, as things get darker and darker and darker for Beowulf and ultimately for all of his people. And along the way, we even have other narrative poems inserted, such as the Lay of the Last Survivor, or the father of a son who kills another son, and the father is simply left in this helpless grief, and he can't even try to get revenge, because how can he avenge the death of one son without killing the other son? So what does he do? Notice that more and more and more and more in the latter part of the poem, people are caught in circumstances which are now beyond their control. And as we'll be talking about a little bit later on, particularly in connection with Hamlet, this is one of the principal differences between comedy and tragedy. So in a sense, the first part of Beowulf is comic, not in the ha-ha-ha comic sense, but in the plotting sense of it being a plot in which things work out successfully and therefore happily for the hero and for the major figures around the hero. And from a plotting point of view, that's really what comedy is all about. Whereas in the case of tragedy, one of the things that we experience is a good and decent and honorable person or group of persons who simply are overwhelmed by forces that they try to control but ultimately cannot control. And of course, that's what happens with Beowulf. It's also what happens with Oedipus. It's also what happens with Hamlet and Lear and Othello and Macbeth and so forth. And this is of the very essence of tragedy viewed from the perspective of the plot, that is to say, how the action is put together. So, we have a number of approaches to this whole question of, well, what makes Beowulf, in some sense, a unified poem? Now, in our time, and by in our time, I'm talking about, say, the last 20 years or so, literary critics have been much less interested in questions of unity as they have focused more and more on how things may not always be smoothly and organically unified, and how there may be all kinds of dissonances and silences and gaps and inconsistencies in literary works, and that these need not be regarded as flaws in the work, but those may, in fact, be precisely the things that create interest in the work. Well, I'm not going to get off into that debate right now, except simply to say that critics in the last, say, 10 to 20 years have been less troubled by questions of unity in works like Beowulf than was the case earlier, when critics were looking much more for a kind of Aristotelian organic unity in works. And we'll talk more about that as we go along. You may be a little bit mystified by some of my language right now, but this is going to become clearer as we go along, and as we take up another literary work, and then another literary work, and another literary work, and so forth. And we talk about not only things like character and action and motive and so forth, but we will also be talking about plot construction. And that's what we're talking about right at the moment. To say nothing of the fact that the character of Beowulf gives a unity to the work. I mean, after all, From one point of view, this is really about the life of Beowulf and the lives of those other people whose lives impinge upon the life of Beowulf in one way or another. So, just be thinking about that as another kind of question among the various questions we've been raising about the poem. Well, at the end of our last meeting, we had been talking about how the Geatish warriors are wearing their helmets with boar images on the cheek guards. And I had made the observation that frequently among these peoples, there will be an association of a tribal group or even, say, a war band, such as here, with certain animals. Now, we don't exactly know what that means other than the obvious. To associate oneself with the qualities of the boar is to associate one's warlike qualities with one of the fiercest and most dangerous animals on earth. So, and by the way, I think I mentioned, or I should have mentioned, or I will now mention, that in the reconstruction of the helmet found at Sutton Hoo, which now resides in the British Museum, in the British Library, I keep saying British Museum in the British Library because it used to be called simply the British Museum, but now the British Museum itself resides in the British Library. But in any event, the old British Library, because there's also a new one. But in any event, the helmet, as reconstructed by the specialists at the British Museum, has these images on the sides of boars. Very, very interesting. If you ever get a chance, take a look at that. Or you know what else you can do in this marvelous age of information technology is you can simply use a search engine like Google or any other good search engine and just type in Sutton Hoo. Remember? Sutton Hoo, two words. S-U-T-T-O-N space H-O-O. And what you will get is you'll get to a series of websites in which you will see the displays, pictorial displays, of the artifacts that I've been talking about. So, okay. I also mentioned that they're wearing mail shirts. They don't wear that heavy sheet metal until the very end of the Middle Ages and the beginning of the early modern period as weaponry changes at the end of the Middle Ages. For one thing, with the introduction of gunpowder and the use of grapeshot, muskets, that sort of thing. But in most of the Middle Ages, people were wearing ringed mail. Those are those little rings that interlock with one another, sometimes doubly so. And by the way, in case you were ever wondering what it might be like to be wearing a ringed mail shirt, I am told by a former professor of mine who actually put this to a test with his professor that they run, depending upon the size, because obviously they're different sizes for different sizes of men, they run between 40 and 60 pounds. Now, given that Beowulf is a pretty big guy, he's probably at the high end of that. So here is Beowulf is a pretty big guy who's wearing a mail shirt, 60 pounds. He also generally has on his helmet, and he may be carrying some kind of a large sword. And we're talking about big swords, these broad swords that they fought with, which were two-handled swords. This is not the kind of thing that's done with French foils. And he swims with all of this on. He swims down into the mare after Grendel's mother, to fight Grendel's mother. And he's fully armed with all this stuff. Wow, this is really something. And look at his other swimming feats in Beowulf. And once again, it appears that he is similarly garbed. Well, okay. Let me draw your attention to something else. This is still early on in the poem, and then we're going to move a little more rapidly to some of the other key scenes in Beowulf. That after the Coast Guard has challenged them, been satisfied that they have good intentions and are on a good mission there in the land of the Geats, he directs them to the court of Hrothgar, but then he leaves them. And they go up the path to Hrothgar's great hall, and when they get there, they once again are challenged. Why? Because as in the case of the Coast Guard's challenge earlier on, you don't just let a force of armed men come into your domain, and especially into the court of the king, until you first of all know who these guys are and what they're up to. So there are a series of challenges, and there's a series of formal encounters and exchanges taking place, which apparently have to do, in a certain sense, with the etiquette of such procedures. So, or protocols, as we might call them nowadays. So we have Hrothgar's herald. He's a certain Wolfgar, and he wants to know what their business are. What their business is. And Beowulf, for the first time, says who he is. Beowulf is mean Nama. Beowulf is my name. And so then Wolfgar goes in and tells Hrothgar, and Hrothgar says, oh yeah, I know him. I knew his father well. His father got involved in a terrible feud, and he was forced into exile lest he lose his life. And he came to the Danish court when I was first a young king. And I not only gave him safety and shelter, but I also settled the feud for him through paying compensation. And he gave me pledges at that time of his loyalty. This is Beowulf's father. So it's very clear to Hrothgar that the reason why Beowulf now has come is that Beowulf is paying off that debt of loyalty on behalf of his father, despite the fact that his father is no longer alive. So, of course, he says, yes, bring him in. Once again, Wolfgar comes out from this inner place where the king is, and says to Beowulf and Beowulf's retainers, some of you can come in, certainly Beowulf can come in, and some of you may come in with Beowulf, the others can stay here with your gear, but you have to stack all of your weapons. You have to stack your weapons. Once again, it's not because they are any longer fearful of Beowulf and his men, it is simply a matter of common sense as well as of protocol. You don't simply let a group of heavily armed men come in before the king. I mean, it's just like we wouldn't want to see heavily armed strangers come into the presence of the President of the United States, right? Certainly not without being seriously challenged by the Secret Service. Well, that's the kind of thing that's going on here, except through an early medieval set of protocols. Now, again, Beowulf comes in. He talks about some of the great deeds that he's already performed in fighting against monsters. And what is he doing? He's establishing his credentials, isn't he? This is why you can rely on me. Here's my record for handling such dangerous situations. Now, of course, he's going to be challenged himself by Unferth. But before we get to that, let me say that Beowulf, when he is presenting, in effect, his credentials, says that he also understands that Grendel does not fight with any weapon. And so, therefore, he himself, Beowulf, will fight Grendel without a weapon. which of course is something, you know, really pretty extraordinary here. And then we get over to the section which is entitled The Feast at Heorot, and Unferth almost immediately challenges Beowulf and says, wait a minute now, are you the Beowulf who got involved in that swimming contest, possibly a rowing contest? The Old English word here, the verb, can be translated either as swimming or as rowing. And obviously it makes more common sense, if you need to make common sense out of it, that this is a rowing, as in with small boats, a rowing contest rather than a swimming contest, because they're out in the middle of winter in the North Sea. For days, the storms all around them. So that would be an extraordinary feat, even rowing in a boat. But it would be way beyond an extraordinary feat if it were swimming. So Beowulf then tells his version of the story, that he was not really bested in the contest by Breca, as Unferth would like to suggest. And he responds to Unferth with, well, my dear friend Unferth, Beora drunken is what the original says. Drunken with beer, you know, besotted with beer. You know, that not only is already a way of dismissing what Unferth has said, after all, you know, this is the drunk in the corner sounding off, but also it's a way of getting Unferth in a way off the hook. Okay, Unferth, I understand, you know, you've just had too much to drink. Because notice elsewhere, especially later on, he really treats Unferth very respectfully. And Unferth is treated by Hrothgar very respectfully. So it may be that here it would be more consistent to say that he's really kind of giving Unferth an excuse for behaving the way he does, which is really in many ways quite impolite towards the guest. So then Beowulf tells his version of the Breca swimming or rowing contest, in which what he says is, you know, look, what happened was that there were these terrible storms and we just got separated in the storms after staying together for a very long time. And then I had to fight sea monsters, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, but I survived, obviously. And he turns the story to his advantage. Once again, he is a slayer of monsters under very difficult and dangerous circumstances. Wealtheo appears in line 6, 11, 12, in line 6, 12 of the poem. And this is very important. Wealtheo is the queen of King Hrothgar. And you remember what I said before about the role of women in Anglo-Saxon or in general Germanic societies, Northern European societies. The status accorded to women was generally higher than it was in the Mediterranean South. And also, the woman had control over the goods of the house, generally speaking. And here, that's what she's doing. She is ceremonially, as well as ceremoniously, dispensing the goods of the house in the form of the goblet that she is bringing first to her husband, the king, to drink from, and then to the guests. And this is, of course, a very important symbolic action here, not only of welcoming people, but also of her sharing the goods of the house with the guests. And then we learn, when Beowulf begins to speak in 632, that Beowulf makes a great boast. Now, boasting in this culture is okay. It's like Yogi Berra, the great New York Yankee catcher one time said in one of his famous yogiisms, "It ain't bragging if you can do it." And that's exactly what happens here. It ain't bragging if you can do it. Beowulf says, here's what I'm going to do. And notice that in this culture, when somebody makes a boast, or beot in the Old English, when somebody makes a boast, what the person is doing is pledging his honor to fulfill whatever it is he is boasting about. If he says, I'm going to fight and I'm going to defeat this enemy, in one sense that's a boast, but in another sense it is a pledge of his honor. So if later on he runs off in the face of danger, people can come back and say, well, what was all that boasting about? Over the beer, or over the mead, or over the wine. That's what happens at the end of Beowulf. When Wiglaf goes to help Beowulf, he says that the reason why he does that is because he felt a very powerful sense of loyalty to Beowulf and had always said that he would be loyal to Beowulf. And then after Beowulf and he kill the dragon, and Beowulf, of course, is mortally wounded, Wiglaf goes to the other retainers who hid in the woods, and he says, I can remember lots of times when you guys over the beer drinking were saying how you would always come to the aid of your lord, and look here, without your aid, he has died, or is in the process of, well, he's died. And so notice that that comes up over and over and over again in this literature. And if we had more time, if this were, of course, in medieval literature, and only in medieval literature, we would be reading a lot of different narratives in which this kind of thing comes up. Okay. So then, of course, Beowulf is going to have to live up to his boast, which he does. Everybody goes to the outbuildings where it is safe for them to stay. Beowulf and his men bed down in the hall. And remember what I said yesterday about the hall being a kind of communal area for people? It is described at different times that they get bedding, apparently out of some closets or chests, and bolsters, which are pillows. And they put these different forms of bedding down and they go to sleep. Well, all but one in this case. Beowulf stays awake and he's propped up on one arm when Grendel comes crashing into the hall, and Beowulf very coolly watches while Grendel picks up one of the other guys and kills him. You know, and you sort of wonder, well, wait, why didn't Beowulf jump in and save his comrade? Well, who knows? That's one of the points about which people can argue in the poem. It may be that he just didn't have a chance to, that he wasn't just laying back and watching Grendel's fighting style or attack style at the expense of one of his own men. Well, in any event, then, Beowulf, who has a grip with the power of 30 men, he grabs hold of Grendel, and he appears to use some kind of wrestling hold on him. Because remember, he's not fighting with weapon. Some years ago, the professor, who was a wonderful gentleman, told me when I first came to the University of Houston, and he was the senior person in my field, he said, you know, I remember being at a conference a few years ago, which now would be quite a few years ago, in which there was a paper circulating among people who were scholars of this literature, which had been written by a former professional wrestler. And this professional wrestler had decided to retire from wrestling. He'd made enough money. He'd always wanted to go to college. And so he went back to school and went to college. And in the course of studies, was taking this course and was reading Beowulf. And he wrote a paper on what wrestling holds Beowulf would have to have used in order to produce the result that he does. Which ultimately means, you know, that he doesn't just dislocate Grendel's shoulder, which is not very hard to do, but he rips his arm and shoulder off. Well, you know, at least according to this former professional wrestler, there were certain kinds of tactics and certain kinds of wrestling holds that would have to have been used to produce that result. What do I know? I'm no expert on wrestling, but I pass that along because it's an interesting story, at any rate. And you will notice that Beowulf's men do try to help against Grendel. And they've got their swords out, and they're dancing around and striking out at Grendel, but all to no avail, because apparently Grendel has been able to work some kind of a magical charm against blades so that no blade can cut him. Well, okay. The next day, everybody is wondering over all of this, because here's the arm and hand, and part of the shoulder at least, of Grendel on display. And obviously, he is not going to have lived very long, right? Because obviously he'd be hemorrhaging when he stormed out of the hall and could have not gotten very far alive. And then we have the shop singing the narrative. Remember what I said last time, that poems, including narrative poems, were sung or chanted, typically to the accompaniment of a harp. That's why you have all these references to a harp. Parts of the harp at Sutton Hoo also survived, and there's a reconstruction, once again by experts in the field, of the Sutton Hoo harp, which appears to be representative of the kinds of harps that they used. They're relatively small instruments so that they could actually be held like this. I mean, if one's using one's left hand, obviously, you know, you can do it either way. And then it would be strummed like this. And what most scholars believe is that the strumming of the strings would coincide with the beats of the poetry, which also are signaled, at least in strong stresses, through alliteration. We haven't really talked about that, but let me go to the tablet. Let's see, Scott, I'm going to go to this now. Whoops. What happened? Am I? Woo. Alliteration, okay. Alliteration is something like the boy blasted a bomb. Hear the b-b-b sounds? When you have a series of sounds like that together, particularly in the same line of poetry, that's alliteration. Old English poetry depends metrically on alliteration. And if we had this in the original, you'd really be able to see this. To some extent, Haney does reproduce this when he'll have things like repeated in songs about Sigmund's exploits. You have the S's, the S sounds, alliterating. Or partners in the fight, friends in need, with the F sounds, alliterating, and so forth. Okay, so those kinds of stresses and those kinds of sounds could very well have been accentuated with the strumming patterns on the harp. So we have the shop singing the legendary song of Sigmund, also a slayer of monsters, and significantly of a dragon with a horde, which of course parallels Beowulf at the end. And then Hrothgar gives a speech, and notice in this whole section from a roughly now on, Hrothgar's speeches sound awfully Christian at times. You will have noticed, no doubt. And that's anachronistic, isn't it? In the sense that we've earlier been told that these people, after all, are, quote, heathenish. That is to say, that they did not know God in God's ways. And that's why they were tempted to go to pagan shrines and even pray to the killer of souls, the devil. Well, if that's true, then how could such persons be giving speeches in which they make all these references to God Almighty and the Father Almighty, Lord of all and Lord of creation, and so on and so on and so on? That language sounds awfully Christian, doesn't it? So that's another one of the things that people argue about in the poem. How are these elements of the pagan and the Christian interwoven? That is to say, with one another in the poem. Well, Hrothgar, of course, then gives all kinds of marvelous gifts to Beowulf. And again, we have a reminder of the importance of gift giving. We've talked about that a good deal already, that that's one of the things that forges the alliance among peoples, is the giver of the gift now has established a new kind of relationship, or reinforced an old relationship, with the person to whom the gift is given. And this is essential to what Tacitus, the Roman historian of the Germanic people, called the comitatus that we talked about last time. And here we have the shop again, singing, and this time a long lay about Finn. Well, then we have various other things going on with Wealtheow addressing Hrothgar, her husband, and then Wealtheow addressing Beowulf, and among other things, she wants to make sure that Beowulf will help to protect her young sons. Apparently, she has pretty young sons, and she's fearful because if her husband, who, I mean, we don't know how old these people are, but it sounds like her husband's a good deal older than she is, and he's probably going to die before too much longer because, you know, actuarial tables for Anglo-Saxon England, which are actually based on forensic pathology, that is to say, going into grave sites and figuring out how old people were at the times that they died and what they died of and so forth. What those actuarial studies of Anglo-Saxon England demonstrate is that if you survived infancy and early childhood, which was always sort of dicey because lots of children died very, very young, but if you survived until, say, you were 19, then your chances of getting from 19 to 30 were about half and half. Can you imagine? If you were 19, as some of you may be, in fact, in this room, then your chances of getting to be 30 is pretty young, right? In the great scale of things, were only half and half. The average age at which a man died was between 33 and 34, the average age for a woman dying was about a year younger than that, and probably that's accounted for by the fact that some women died in childbirth. So mortality rates were just slightly higher for women. But the But then if you got to be 30, your chances of getting to be 50 were about 1 in 7 to 9. I mean, that's really amazing. You know, you didn't have a very good chance of getting to be 50 years old. So age obviously meant something very different than it does to us. I mean, in our culture, with modern medicine and what we know about nutrition and exercising and so forth, I mean, we have lots of very hale and hearty and very athletic women and men in their 70s. You know, that just isn't what it used to be. But, you know, in the time of Beowulf, to be 50 years old could really be an old guy. And while it's true that some people would survive longer than that, very few did. So, okay, and she's worried about what's going to happen to her young sons, because what if they're not old enough to take care of themselves and to protect themselves? They become vulnerable, right? And somebody who wants to carry out a coup could very easily do away with her young sons. That happened in the Middle Ages and beyond. So she's looking to Beowulf, if need be, to give protection to her sons, again, if need be. So they go to bed, but we find out that Beowulf's going to go to bed somewhere else. Why is that an important point? Because Grendel's mother now comes in to avenge the death of her son. And again, we have this description of how, you know, she's of the kin of Cain and so on and so on. And why doesn't Beowulf stop her? Well, that was the whole point of saying that Beowulf was sleeping somewhere else, in one of the outbuildings, apparently. And so what does she do? She grabs one of the warriors to kill him. And then the others all wake up and they draw out their swords and they start attacking her. And she, in desperation, simply rushes out the door and gets away. And she goes to the mayor. She goes to the mayor. Now, let's see if I can manage this. The mayor. Mare is a word for a body of water. The only place that I can remember right offhand that it survives into modern English is as part of a compound word. Anybody think what that might be? Yeah.
Mariner.
Mariner is good. That's good. But it's not quite accurate. It's mermaid. Remember I mentioned werewolf? Where is the Anglo-Saxon or Old English word for man? And where survives, as far as I know, only in the compound werewolf. So also with mermaid. This is the maid of the mer, or of the mare. Okay? So that's what we have here in Beowulf now. All right. So Beowulf goes out, and what does he see around the mare? He sees all these horrible, 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 monstrous, you know, snakes and dragon-like figures and serpentine figures. And this is such a terribly dangerous place, as has already been described by Hrothgar, right? In a famous description. You know, it is dark, it is treacherous, it is filled with these horrible, horrible, dangerous animals. And that's where Grendel and Grendel's mother have lived, apparently for a very, very long time. Well, Beowulf finally dives down into the mare. He swims underwater, and he comes up in an underground cave. because there's air in there. And so there he encounters Grendel's mother. And Grendel's mother grabs him, and he tries to use the sword that Unferth had given him, and it doesn't really do any good, because remember, there's this charm, apparently, against blades being effective against not only Grendel, but here it would appear against Grendel's mother as well. And she wrestles with him. He slips on the slippery surface, because remember, it's wet in there, in this underground cave, falls down. She gets on top of him. She pulls out this dagger, and she tries to force it between the links of his mail shirt. But not only does his mail shirt hold, but also, the poet says, Almighty God, Almighty God wished that he survive and that he ultimately prevail. Now, that's what I meant when I was talking last time about an Augustinian conception of history. That from the point of view outlined by St. Augustine, particularly in the City of God, but also elsewhere, God has ruled over all human history, even those parts of humanity that are not Christian. And even if they didn't know that God was ruling over them, God nevertheless was directing their history, even the lives of individuals. And so also here. This is another way in which Christian thought is brought into the poem. But Beowulf finally does get the upper hand. He sees a magical sword at one end of the cave. He grabs that, and he is able to kill Grendel's mother. Then he cuts off the head of Grendel. Grendel's dead body is lying at the other end of the cave. He cuts off the head of Grendel, and he swims up through the waters, which, by the way, are now cleansed, with just the hilt of the sword, because the sword has simply disintegrated otherwise. Grendel's head is a trophy. And they go back and have another great celebration at Heorot with singing and all of the rest. And we are coming to the end of this hour, and so we're about to take a break. And we'll come back and we'll finish up our discussion of Beowulf and then move on.